Good morning, everybody. Let's all stand together and sing, lifting our voices to Jesus this morning. Amen. Amen. All right, let's go. Let's put our hands together. Here we go.
With all of my heart, with all of my heart, I will praise you, Lord, with all of my heart, with all of my heart, with all of my heart, I will praise you, Lord, with all of my heart.
Blessed be the name of the Lord.
Blessed be the name of the Lord.
Oh,
blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord Most High. Oh, blessed be the name of the Lord.
Oh,
blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord Most High.
Sound good this morning.
Amen.
Well, thank you, all three of you. If you're happy to be in God's house, say amen.
Amen.
We're so glad that you're here. I am so excited and want to give a great praise. You know, we've been praying for a long time for Brother Dan Fisher, and he was in class teaching this morning. He's here today.
Oh.
Praise the Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Continue to pray for Brother Dan. He's still in therapy, but it's great to see you here today, sir. If you're our guest today, we want to welcome you to Central Baptist Church, and we hope and pray that you were made to feel welcome the moment that you showed up on the campus here today. But we ask you to do us a little favor. Up in the seat back, up in front of you, there's some card holders, and one of those cards is called a Connect card. If you'll take a moment today before leaving to fill that out for us, we would love to have a written record of your visit with us today, and you can just turn it into one of the offering boxes there by all the exits on your way out today. We would love for you to turn that in. We promise you we don't share it with anybody. It stays in our office. We would simply like the opportunity to reach back out to you. If you're joining us online today through our live stream, you can go to our website at cbchou.org, and you can fill out an online Connect card. We would love to know that you're with us as well. At this time, let me ask you, if you would, let's bow our heads together and ask God's blessing on our service today. Heavenly Father, we thank you and we praise you, Lord, for your love for us. We thank you and praise you, God, for who you are. And Lord, we're grateful to be in your house this morning to worship you. We ask your blessings upon this service today. We pray, Lord, that your Holy Spirit would speak through our pastor, Lord, that you would touch our hearts, that you would draw us all closer to you this morning. And God, we'll thank you and we'll praise you for it. In Jesus' name, amen.
Let's continue together in worship this morning. Do you see who we have up here with us? Miss Sharon's singing right beside us this morning.
Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty, early in the morning, our song shall rise to thee. Holy, 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 merciful and mighty, God in three persons, blessed.
For all The world is crowding our souls with noise. Messages, notifications. They begin when our alarm goes off in the morning and continue until we go to sleep at night. The problem is, so much of what we see and hear, the endless information we encounter, it's just noise. It doesn't matter. It's meaningless. But what God has to say to us through His Word, through prayer, through His people, that's different. That's what matters. His presence, it's rest for our weary souls. It's peace for our worried minds. It's hope for our troubled hearts. We don't have to earn His attention. We don't have to work for His love. It's already ours. It is freely given. He's waiting for us to be with Him. There is nothing more important. Nothing matters more than being present with God.
Near me, Lord, shining with compassion.
light shine down on me. Let your love shine through me in the night. Day star shine down on me. Let your love shine through me.
Man, open your Bibles. Just open them somewhere and then God will bless that. Amen. But if you'd like to go to Mark 16 and the book of Acts chapter 1, you might be where I'd like to read this morning. As soon as you get there, stand with me, please. I'm going to read just a few verses out of the book of Acts, chapter 1. We've been going the last 6 or 7 weeks from the upper room to the Garden of Gethsemane to the trial where Jesus Christ was falsely accused and tried and sentenced to death, was taken out on Calvary's hill and crucified, buried in a borrowed tomb, raised the third day, and appeared unto his disciples and followers. And then we come to his last meeting on this earth. A former treatise made thee, O Theophilus, of thee, Jesus, he began both to do and teach, until the day in the which he was taken up, after that he, through the Holy Ghost, had given commandments unto his apostles, whom he had chosen. Stay right there in Mark 16. What commandments did he give his disciples? Mark 16 and verse 15. Go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. He that believeth and is baptized shall be saved, and he that believeth not shall be damned. Verse 3 of Acts 1. To whom also he showed himself alive after his passion by many infallible proofs being seen of them 40 days and speaking of the things pertaining to the kingdom of God, and being assembled together with them, commanded them that they should not depart from Jerusalem, but wait for the promise of the Father, which saith he, ye have heard of me, referring back to John 14 and John 16, when he promises the Comforter will come, and when he comes, he will indwell them, he will empower them, he will enable them to accomplish everything that Jesus Christ commands them to accomplish. For truly, John baptized with water, but ye shall be baptized with the Holy Ghost not many days hence. They therefore were come together. They asked of him, saying, Lord, wilt thou at this time restore again the kingdom of Israel? And he said to them, it's not for you to know the times and the season which the Father hath put in his own power. But ye shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost is come upon you, and you shall be witnesses unto me both in Jerusalem and Judea and in Samaria and in the uttermost part of the earth. And when he had spoken these things, while they watched him, while they beheld him, while they had their eyes fastened upon him, he was taken up, and a cloud received him out of their sight. Father, I pray you would bless the reading of your word. May you bless the hearing of your word, and may you put it in our hearts to be obedient to the commands of your word. I pray this morning, Lord, you'll be honored with everything that's said and done in this service. And may Jesus Christ be exalted. And may we, his people, be encouraged to take up the responsibilities we have as followers of Jesus Christ, in whose name we pray. Amen. You may be seated. The parting words of Jesus Christ. Last thing he said on this earth. I've got to tell you this morning that as a pastor, 44 years as a pastor, I have an archive of memories of the last things that people that I pastored have said to me, and things that I remember so vividly and so well. I remember visiting with Hester Kite. She was at hospice over Memorial City just in her final hours. And I was standing there in the room, and she said, "Now, preacher, you're not always going to be that good looking." She said, "You won't always have that dark black hair." She said, "Your blue eyes will probably get dim with age and you'll get all wrinkled. But," she said, "don't ever quit preaching the word of God and never stop loving people, because that's what makes you, you." Remember when I went to Phoenix to pastor Tabernacle Baptist Church, 3 or 4 months into me being there, a couple showed up at the invitation of another family. And you could just see the stress and the unhappiness and the torture in this woman's face. And they came and through 2 or 3 weeks, and I went out to visit them. And she said, "My life has been a hell on earth for the last 15 years. She said, "Every day I live in torment." She said, "I was married." And she said, "We had a very successful aviation business over at Sky Harbor Airport." And she said, "We were doing very well financially." And she said, "But we had a lot of problems in our marriage." She said, "One morning," she said, "my husband and I got into a knockdown drag out." And she said, "I said, why don't you get out of here?" And she said, "Hopefully I'll never have to see you again. I wish you were dead." She said, about an hour later, my phone rang. I answered the phone. And she said, the woman at the airport said, "Just a moment, just a moment." And she said, she turned my husband's radio into the phone. And he called her by name and said, "Hey, you're going to get your wish. You will never see me again." And he flew his plane into Camelback Mountain and died. She said, "I have to live with those words every day of my life." You know, parting words, last words, they can either be a curse or they can be a blessing. Here in Acts chapter 1, the text records the Lord's last words. It's his last meeting with his disciples while he's here on earth. He's preparing to ascend back to the heavens to sit at the right hand of God, according to Hebrews 7:25, as an intercessor for us. And before he leaves, he commands and he commissions his followers to reach the world with his message. He reminds them that they must focus on the ministry that he's leaving to them. And he reminds them, church, keep the main thing, the main thing. Even here in Acts chapter 1, you see that Jesus had to overcome some distractions of his disciples. He gives them this command, tells them what they're supposed to do. And they said, yeah, but Lord, what about when are you going to restore your kingdom? You see, the disciples wanted to talk about future things while Jesus Christ is trying, he's trying to conduct the first evangelistic conference to man, and they wanted to turn it into a prophecy conference. Jesus said the times and the seasons shouldn't be your concern. Your responsibility is to be faithful to him and work for me while I am gone and while you wait for my return. I think we're equally easily distracted from the most important things of life. Nothing's really changed. Our duty's not to get distracted. We're not to really concentrate and be overcome with prophecy and future events or theological disputes that distract us from the main thing. We need to be careful that we don't allow Satan to distract us from the purpose for which Jesus Christ left us in this world. Our duty is to be focused upon this one thing. Not the return of Jesus Christ, but reaching people with the gospel of Jesus Christ. Jesus said over in John 17 and verse 18, when he's praying there in the Garden of Gethsemane, Jesus prayed to the Father and he said, as thou hast sent me into the world, even so have I also sent them, his followers, into the world. He says in verse 20 of John 17, neither pray I for these alone, but for them also which shall believe on me through their works. The reason we're here today is because those followers of Jesus Christ were faithful to what God had commissioned them to do. And they spread the gospel throughout the known world. And even to this day, 2,000 years later, we're still being affected by the message, the good news of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Jesus said in John 20 and verse 21, then Jesus said to them, peace be unto you. As my Father has sent me, even so send I you. From the very day that Jesus arose from the dead in eternal victory, he began the process of preparing his disciples for his departure. Jesus knew that he would be ascending back to heaven and that his followers would be responsible for getting the message of redemption and salvation and eternal forgiveness to a needy world. That was the commission, what we call the Great Commission. Matthew talks about it in Matthew 28. Luke talks about it in Luke 24. Mark talks about it here in chapter 16. And if we're going to carry out that message, then we need to understand exactly what that message would require. They needed to know that there would be successes and there would be failures. They needed to know that some would accept and believe and others would reject the message. We find that recorded, and I'm not going to take time to read it, but in Acts chapter 17, verse 31 through 34, where Paul is preaching on Mars Hill, and it said, and some believed, and some rejected, and some said, we'll hear this later. But it said, and many believed because of his words. We need the encouragement. We need words of comfort. We need words of hope. We need words of instruction. And that's exactly what they heard from Jesus here as he stood on the Mount of Olives. And what I want to do this morning is just look at these parting words of Jesus Christ to his disciples. What were the last words that echoed in the ears of his followers. He said, you will be witnesses unto me in Jerusalem and in Judea and in Samaria and in the uttermost part of the world. Jesus Christ told them the requirement of a saint. He talked about the responsibility of the sinner. And he talks about the recognition of the servant. Notice the requirement for the saint. He says in verse 15 of Mark 16, go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. Our message, the disciples were told to preach the gospel. They're to go into the world bearing the good news of salvation to everybody who will hear it. And that word gospel, that's what it means, good news. And that's exactly what the gospel is. In fact, it's described in Romans chapter 1 and verse 1 as the gospel of God because it originates in God's love for man. Over in 2 Corinthians chapter 10 and verse 14, it's referred to as the gospel of Jesus Christ because it flows from his sacrifice upon the cross. In Acts 20 and verse 24, it's called the gospel of God's grace. It saves those whom the law curses. Over in Ephesians chapter 1 and verse 13, it's called the gospel of your salvation. Because as Romans 1:16 said, it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone who believeth, to the Jew first and also to the Greek. The gospel is comprised of three essential components. According to Romans or 1 Corinthians 15 and verse 3 and verse number 4. And he said, for I delivered unto you first of all that which I also received, how that Christ died for our sins according to the Scripture, and that he was buried and he rose again the third day according to the Scriptures. The gospel, what is it? Christ died for our sins according to the Scripture. Church, that's the good news. Jesus Christ died for our sins, and everyone who will believe, everyone who will put their faith and trust in him shall be saved. John 6:47, whoever believes has everlasting life. Titus chapter 2 and verse 14, Titus says, he gave himself for us that he might redeem us from all iniquity and purify unto himself a peculiar people zealous for good works. When Jesus Christ went to the cross, when he suffered the agony, the shame, the separation from God, he did it all so that you and I could be saved, that we might be forgiven. 2 Corinthians 5 and 21 said, he became sin for us who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteous of God in Jesus Christ. 1 Peter 2 and verse 24, he bore our sins in his own body on the tree, that we being dead to sin should live unto righteousness, and by his stripes we are healed. We can be saved because of the sacrifice of Jesus Christ. It is a truth that we must believe. Not only did he die according to the Scripture, but he was buried. You know, and I think sometimes we don't even grasp this truth. Even though Jesus Christ was buried, over in the book of Ephesians chapter 4 verses 8 through 10 and 1 Peter chapter 3 verses 18 through 20, it tells us that Jesus walked into that place where the souls of all the departed were being held. And there's it's called the bosom of Abraham, that portion of paradise of Abraham's bosom. And Hades, the grave, whatever you want to identify, was divided into two parts. There was the paradise, Abraham's bosom. And all of those in the Old Testament who died, they were held in that place awaiting for redemption to be accomplished. There was also in that place another portion, and it was called hell, where the souls of all lost are departed. Jesus talked about it in Luke chapter 16, verses 19 through 31. And every lost sinner from Cain to the very last person who's died this day are being held in that place, waiting the judgment of God. And when Jesus Christ died on the cross and was put in the tomb, it said that Jesus Christ walked into that place, that paradise place called Hades, and he proclaimed the good news that he had died for sin and for sinners. He told Abraham and Isaac and Jacob and David and Moses and the rest that redemption's plan had been completed. And then he led them out of that place. And that's why over Matthew chapter 27, verse 52 and 53 said, and they saw the graves and they saw the saints of those who were dead walking the street of the holy city. But he also told those lost souls in that place that their unbelief had confirmed that they were doomed to that place for eternity in separation of God and in torment. Because of their unbelief. I believe he proclaimed that he had forever delivered his people from the bondage of Satan and sin and hell. And Jesus says, every soul free from the bondage of a futile life. And then the gospel says, and he rose again the third day according to the scriptures. The good news is that Jesus Christ rose from the dead, from the grave in power and in victory. The resurrection was God's amen to a sinless life, to a substitutionary sacrifice. And the Lord Jesus, on our behalf, he gave his sinless life to die in our place. And if Jesus would have been any ordinary man, he'd have still been in the grave. But he was God in human flesh, and he came out of that grave to redeem us from a sinful life. Jesus Christ had no sin, and therefore he could give himself for our sin. Jesus was able to walk out of the tomb in victory and power, promising eternal life to all who believe in his precious name. Church, have we forgotten his parting words? Go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. That's the message that he's given us. It's good news because God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but shall have everlasting life. It's good news. Hebrews 7:25. Wherefore he is able to save them to the uttermost that come unto him, seeing that he ever liveth to make intercession for their sins. That word uttermost means that no one is too bad, no one is too evil, nobody has sinned too much. Jesus Christ can reach down in the very depths of the human heart, knowing everything that man has ever done, everything he's ever said, everything he's ever thought. And Jesus Christ's precious blood can redeem man from the curse of the law and his sin. And if you believe that message, if we really believe that message can change the world, then why in the world don't we share it with others more than what we do? If you're a Christian this morning, you've not been saved because your mother took you to Sunday school from the time you were an infant. You're not a Christian this morning because you never missed Sunday school and you never missed the youth department. You're not a Christian this morning because you've been faithful in church. No, you're a Christian this morning because Jesus Christ died for our sins according to the scripture. He was buried and on the third day he rose from the grave. That's what makes us a Christian. It's the message that Jesus Christ said in his parting word. Take that message to all the world, and those that believe shall be saved, and those that reject shall be lost. That's the message that we take. What is the mission field? His disciples were told to take the good news into all the world. No place was off limits. No group was left out. It made no difference how wicked they were. It made no difference where they lived, what they looked like, what they sounded like. They were to be given the good news that Jesus Christ had paid the price that God required for sin to be forgiven. And church, the mission field hasn't changed. And we're endeavor to reach every creature on this earth with the good news of Jesus Christ. Tell it. Tell the good news. Whether it's across the ocean or whether it's across the street. We are to either open our mouth and tell others, or we're to open our pocketbooks and send missionaries around the world who are engaged in reaching the people of this world with the gospel. We're to take heed to Christ's parting words. And the question is this: if you've experienced Christ's redemption, how in the world can we remain silent? You probably heard me tell the story about when I went with Don Espinosa in 1982, after he went back down to Argentina in 1979. He'd been in a car wreck and broke his neck, and he had to recover here in the States. Hadn't been back down to his churches in 3 years, and he was with us on a Sunday and said, Central Baptist, would you let Brother Mattis go with me back to Argentina? And the church said, yeah, we'd love to get rid of him for a while. But we went back, we were riding up through the Andes Mountains. Him and Ray Masters, the other missionary in Argentina. And we're way up in these mountains, just beautiful place, and very sparsely populated. And we stopped at one of those little roadside, I don't know if it's a taco stand or burrito stand, just a little feeding station on the side of the road. And while we're sitting there, this old cowboy rode up on his horse. And he got off his horse, he must have been 60, 70 years old. And when he looked over and he saw Don Espinosa, his face just lit up like a Christmas tree. Señor! Señor! Un momento, señor! And he opened his little saddle bag and he took out this little cardboard contraption. Don Espinosa, who was Hispanic, never learned Spanish. He was raised in Long Beach, California. And so when he went back down to Argentina, he had an extremely difficult time learning the language. Couldn't learn the language. But he came up with this little contraption they made for him, and it was like a record player. And you would take and put the little cardboard there, and it had a place for you to put either a knife or a pencil and turn it with that little needle. And it was the gospel in Spanish. And as you did it, it just gave you the gospel. He got that thing out of his saddlebag and sat down on the ground and said, Señor, Señor. And he'd be, Christian, Christian, Christ in heart. Don Espinosa knew that if you're willing, if you've got the desire, if you've got the want to, God can use you if you will make yourself available. That man's life had been changed through the gospel of Jesus Christ. And even though someone could not say it with their mouth, they said it on a record player. The message. What is the message? Jesus Christ died according to the scripture. What's the mission field? The world. What's our method? He commanded you are to go and preach. It is a command. It's called the great commission, not the great omission. It's not optional. It's not something we decide will we or will we not. God calls His church and His people into action. Evangelism, church, is not a subject to be debated. It's a command to be obeyed. That phrase, go ye, it's in what we call the perfect aorist tense in the Greek, which means that as you're going, in other words, as you're moving through life, as you've experienced the gospel and now you move through life, take that message with you. It's an ongoing process of what's going on in your life. It's good news that we share with others. We're to tell it with our lips. We are to preach the gospel. And the word preach doesn't mean just so much what I'm doing right now in the pulpit, but rather it means to herald a message the King's message. It is the message that we are to take with authority and assurance. It is something that we've experienced in our own hearts. Therefore, we can share it with others. I've said this, and Roy has said this 1,000 times, but let me repeat it. If you've got a story, if Jesus Christ changed your life, if Jesus Christ forgave you of your sin, if Jesus Christ lives in your heart through the person of the Holy Spirit, just tell somebody what God did for you. That is the good news. But if nothing's ever happened to you, then you don't have a story. And you can't tell them. It's not something that you make up and conscript. It's something that you tell with your lips. Paul said in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17, that we become a new creature in Jesus Christ. And then it says, and God has given to us the ministry of reconciliation. To wit, that God would use you who've been redeemed to bring other people to the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. But you've got to talk about it. You've got to share it with your lips. But you're also to tell it, not just with your lips, but with your lives. We are to live in such a way that when lost people see us, there's an obvious difference in our life and the life of others. There's an obvious difference of what we used to be and what we now are. You may be the only Bible, church, that some people ever read. So be conscious of what other people perceive from your life. I think that's what Paul was talking about in Philippians 1 and verse 27. He said, only let your conversation be as it becometh the gospel of Christ, that you stand fast in one spirit, in one mind, striving for the faith of the gospel. Jesus put it another way in Matthew 5 and verse 16. Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father which is in heaven. I think the question we need to ask ourselves this morning when it comes to our obedience to Christ's parting words is, are we carrying out the Great Commission? How are we doing personally? And how are we doing as a church? That's the requirement of the children of God. That's the reason Jesus Christ left us on this earth when He saved us and didn't take us to heaven, because He needs a voice. He needs a word. He needs a witness. He needs representatives on this earth to share the good news of the gospel with Jesus Christ to lost sinners. Now, what's the responsibility of the sinner? Verse 16 says, and he that believeth and is baptized shall be saved. But he that believeth not shall be damned. As the saints of God, we have the responsibility of sharing the gospel. But the lost have a responsibility when it comes to the gospel. And their responsibility is threefold. First of all, to give an answer. When a sinner, when a lost person, when a person outside of Jesus Christ hears the gospel message, that person becomes individually responsible for the message that they're hearing. If you've never heard the gospel before, when you leave this room this morning, you can never say, well, I didn't know how to be saved. If you're watching via the internet this morning and you're not a Christian, you've never given your life to Christ, you've never been saved from the power of sin, you can never again say, well, I didn't know that I needed to make a decision. The moment you hear the message that Jesus Christ died for sinners, and if you'll invite Him into your heart, you can be saved and forgiven forever. At that moment, once you've heard that message, you become responsible for that message. Salvation occurs when a lost sinner hears the good news of salvation, and the Holy Spirit of God convicts them of sin in their life, and they believe that Jesus Christ loves them, that He died for their sins, that He rose from the dead. And with a repentant heart, they place their faith in Jesus Christ. Instantly, God saves you from the power of sin. If you've never given your life to Jesus Christ, God can change you that quickly by simply believing in your heart what the Word of God says about Jesus Christ. Ephesians 2, verse 8 and 9, we say it so much. Ephesians 2, for by grace are you saved, are you forgiven through faith, and that not of yourself, it's the gift of God. Not of works, lest any person should boast. The moment you hear that Jesus Christ gave His life for you, if you will receive Him into your life, He will forgive you of your sin. Salvation is completely and totally the work of God. Man can only accept the atoning work of Jesus Christ. As Christians, we are to share that message, but it's only the Holy Spirit of God who can do the work of redemption in a person's heart. You must, first of all, He's got to answer. Secondly, the lost sinner has got to act. The Word of God says, believe and be baptized. Now, hang on for just a minute. Baptism is not salvation. Baptism is the public profession of a person's faith in Jesus Christ. Baptism is not essential. It's not required. It's not mandatory. Baptism doesn't get you one inch closer to heaven. Baptism is an act of obedience to the Lord.